at home, Calvary Grace Assembly of God Christmas service.
Yeah. be home for Christmas. You can plan on me. Please have snow and mistletoe and presents on the tree. Christmas Eve will find me where the love light gleams. I'll be home for Christmas, if only
good morning and welcome to Christmas at Home, the day after Christmas. And I trust you all had a great Christmas yesterday. I know the festivities and dinners and get-togethers will continue all the way through into New Year's Day. And it's a very special time of the year. Christmas is just a musical time of the year. Everywhere you go, you hear Christmas carols being sung or played, and it's my favorite time of the year. For many people, the song, I'll Be Home for Christmas, blends some warm memories and some real promises to people. Other holiday songs aim for that sentimental jugular as well, but none hit the target like this one. And I think the reason is simple. The song acknowledges the power of being at home. And you know, if the words were different, like, I'll be at work for Christmas, that just doesn't tug at the heart the same way, does it? You know, back in 1942, the dark days of World War II were everywhere. And with tears and fears around her in Brooklyn, New York, Kim Gannon could find little reason to even celebrate Christmas. To make matters worse, no one was completely sure the United States or her allies could even win that horrible war. And when she sat down to write the words to this poem, with the nightmare of war everywhere, she simply wrote with timeless simplicity of the heartache of being away from home and yet her hope of being at home for Christmas. Walter Kent, he was another New Yorker, also understood the longing for home that holiday season, and quickly composed a tune that blended with Cannon's deeply moving poem. And then on October the 4th, 1943, we all remember Bing Crosby recorded the song and it became an instant hit. And then you have the memories of December 17th, 1903. After four attempts, the Wright brothers flew their flying machine for the first time. And Wilbur rushed to the local telegraph office and he sent off the following message. He said, "We have flown for 12 seconds. We will be home for Christmas." Upon receiving the telegram, their sister, Catherine, went to the newspaper office and told them the news. 2 days later, the local newspapers posted the following headline on page 6, "Wright Brothers Home for Christmas." Amazingly, being home for Christmas trumped their flight feat itself. Surely they were the first to fly, but even more important, they were coming home for Christmas. I've been asked a lot recently, are you going home for Christmas? And repeatedly, I've asked people the very same question. I think, why is that? There's something deep inside of us that longs to be in a place called home, especially at Christmas time. Our concepts and memories of home have particular power when they're, you know, pleasant recollections of Christmas and the things that go on during the Christmas season. We recall gleefully diving into the family feast. I mean, all that food is just a wonderful time of celebration. And when my parents and Dionysia's parents were living, we would take the boys to each one of the houses at Christmas Day and have dinner and lunch at different houses and open all the gifts. And those gift exchanges were amazing. You know, sometimes they were predictable. Aunts and uncles and cousins and grandparents would give you socks and ties and underwear. But I'll never forget my grandma on my mother's side. She'd give you some special gifts. And more than one time on a Christmas day, I opened a box and there was that soap on a rope that she loved to give. And it was funny. We tell the story still today, but we appreciate her so much and love her for it. Some of you couldn't wait to get home for Christmas if you did go home. Others of you don't look forward to going home for Christmas because it's not a happy occasion. And some of you dread this time of year because somebody very special to you, a husband, a wife, a child or a daughter, mom or dad, somebody else, a sibling, has passed away this past year. And this is your first Christmas without them present. We all know that Joseph and Mary were away from home that first Christmas. In fact, in Matthew chapter 1, verse 20, Joseph is told to take Mary home as his wife, but that didn't last long because they had to bounce down to a place called Bethlehem. And the shepherds, because of the nature of their work, they were rarely at home at Christmas time. And the wise men had wandered away from home so they could worship King Jesus. So the family of Jesus set up their home in Bethlehem for a while, but it wasn't long before they had to flee to Egypt and then back to Judea, and finally they ended up in Nazareth. Later, Jesus made Capernaum his home, but during his ministry, the Bible says that even Jesus had no place to lay his head. And Jesus was literally far away from home because he had left his home in heaven. So what kind of family would want to shut out all of the Christmas festivities and keep themselves away from other people and even other family members coming to their home at Christmas time? The sad but true answer is far too many people do that this time of year. These are the families who think of the holidays as anything but a frolic up Walton's Mountain. They only see the ghost of Christmas past because of things that have happened in their family. They remember the unpleasant apparitions taken from, you know, they take on the forms of misbehavior and arguments and bitterness about who didn't or didn't show up last year at the gathering and disappointments over the gifts. I gave something more expensive and you gave me something cheap, and a lot of deep hurt feelings begin to grow. And the original hurts, maybe things happened years ago, but they begin to grow more and more every year with the retelling of that incident or what somebody said to you. And I think, you know, this time of the year, families have a choice. We all do. We can keep the feud in our family going, or we can take steps to heal that feud. And it's really up to you and to me. It requires some initiative. I know it's going to require some compassion. It'll take a little bit of wisdom and the ability to envision reconciliation to move on. And it takes someone with the qualities of God the Father in their life. If you remember the story of the prodigal son, and consider that story. I think it's rarely, if ever, associated with Christmas. But the story has no manger, I know. It has no shepherds, no wise men, no star. The element that makes this story so powerful is simple. A father watches hopefully down the road for his wayward son to come home. The parable is found in Luke chapter 15, and it addresses the question, what makes that prodigal son even want to go home? Let me read you just a part of the story in Luke 15, beginning with verse 17. And it says, but when he came to himself, another translation says, when he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired servants had bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father and will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. And he rose and came to his father. But when he still saw him a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And his son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to the servants, bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet, and bring the fatted calf here and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again, and he was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. You know, the younger brother became so hungry and so poor, he wanted what the pigs would not even eat. And he decided, it's time to swallow my pride and go home. And Jesus said to the younger, said about the younger brother, he came to his senses and headed back to his homeland. You know, the arrival of the baby Jesus is an offer to come home in every sense of the word. His birth and death and resurrection after the ultimate second chance to accomplish the ultimate homecoming for every person. And this is why the parable of the prodigal son should have its rightful place now at Christmas time. As we are one day after Christmas Day and families are still gathering today and over the weekend, what kind of gathering do you anticipate maybe this afternoon or this coming week? Will everybody be there? More to the point, is someone going to be absent that really should be there with you in your home or wherever you may meet? But maybe they're deterred by the barriers of ghosts or walls or fuse that have been propagated, or misunderstandings or shame, or maybe it's just stubborn pride. Which role in the drama of the prodigal son are you going to play this Christmas? You may be the younger brother whose words were always, give me, give me, give me. The second he demanded his share of the estate, he became homeless. His grasping nature was a barrier to his homecoming and had to be utterly destroyed before he could ever go back home. Or maybe you play the role of the older brother, keeping score and targeting the members of your family who don't play by the rules. You may say something like this, home for Christmas? I don't want to see him or her come home after what he did or what they said to me. Or maybe you're like the patient and the hopeful father who is ruled by the force of love and will not be dissuaded by waywardness or vengeance or anything else. The incandescent power of your hope far outshines the hurt of any past offenses you may have. So this parable resonates so powerfully because we spend at least part of our lives playing every one of those roles. But as Her Noen reminds us in his wonderful book, The Return of the Prodigal Son, he says, our progress as Christians requires that we all eventually grow into the role of the Father. And I think we all have to. No matter what people have said or done to us, or how bad we've been hurt, or how much we have given and others have not given back to us, God allows us, through the power of His Holy Spirit, for us to grow and to grow up internally, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually, not just physically. And as we grow up, we begin to embrace the role of the Father, forgiving and loving and wanting to accept people back home. And it requires us to come to our senses sometimes and allow the Holy Spirit to question us. What is my life really all about, and how do I treat others in my life? Do I treat them like Christ would want me to treat them? It also requires that we embrace the number one objective of the Father, and that is to help other people find their way back home this Christmas. I think it's important. If they've been estranged and been afar off and not been a part of your family, you say, oh, they would never come. It's amazing what the power of the Holy Spirit can do in changing a person's life as you begin to intercede and pray for them and say, Lord, forgive me for what I've harbored in my heart against them. I want to forgive them. I want to accept them. I want them to come maybe to my home for Christmas. I want them to come home. So how do we do that? In the parable, the father could see the wayward son from a long distance off. And why was he able to do that? because he was intently looking for him and expecting him to return. What is the expectation that you have this Christmas for reconciliation among your family and close friends? We are all believers, and we can have the same attitude toward those when people don't treat us fairly. So let me encourage you this Christmas, today, starting today, why don't you make the first move? So many differences within families do not move toward healing because we wait for the other person to give up first and come to us and ask us to forgive and make that first move. And the situation never changes because we keep telling the same old story about how they treated us or how we don't get along. And we pick at the old wounds and they never, ever heal. This week of Christmas, let me encourage you. Celebrate the birth of Jesus, who was God's vehicle for reconciling all of humanity back to himself. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave. And he gave his one and only son, the present that was most dearest to him. Let me encourage you to do that this Christmas season. It'll be worth so much more than any tangible gift or any monetary gift that you could ever give or send to somebody. This season, so often peppered by the words like peace and joy, is the perfect time to make the first move, to say you can always come back into my home, back into my family, back into my life, back into my heart. Listen, if Jesus could forgive you, if Jesus could forgive me, if Jesus could accept us after everything that we did against him, then you and I can accept anybody in our home and family and among our friends because we have the same power of forgiveness and reconciliation as a Christian that Jesus had toward us. And I know there's no guarantee of healing or the kind of reunion that the prodigal son had. But think about it this way. The only reason that reunion was possible was because somebody was willing to go first. Let me encourage you. Take the first step. You go first. You be the adult and forgive and reconcile those family members back to yourself. If you have a chance to give this great gift this holiday season, do it. Let me encourage you to reach out. Make the offer of forgiveness and reconciliation. Don't wait for the other person. Do it in the name of Jesus. He's the great reconciler, the redeemer, the maker of all things. He's the reason for this season. There is no time like the present. You can have Christmas at home this year. Would you bow with me in prayer? Father, we just thank you today for 24 hours later after celebrating Christmas Day, but the spirit of Christmas is still here, the spirit of giving, the spirit of forgiveness, the spirit of accepting other people, reconciling others, is still within our hearts, and it will continue into 2022. Lord, if people are watching me online this morning and they're saying, you know, somebody did something to me and I just cannot forget it. It hurt me so bad. I want you to allow, and it will be a choice. Holy Spirit, help them to allow the power of Christ to bring healing into their life, because this is what you want to do this Christmas season, so that you can bring reconciliation between those two individuals. Lord, I pray a special Christmas blessing on our church family and others who are watching us this season. Things may be different this year. Maybe somebody lost a loved one. This is your first Christmas without them. But Jesus promises to be closer to you than a brother, and he will love you as you in turn love him back. We pray God's richest blessings on your people this Christmas season. We ask it all in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. It's been so good to have you with us during this special Home at Christmas celebration service. I trust you and your family will bless this Christmas season. We continue to pray for healing for every one of you who are sick and for God to project to you his desire and his plans for you into a coming new year. Amen. Lord bless you today.